Hello, everyone. Welcome. I'm Annie Reisowitz, the Communications Advisor for the F3 Future of Fish Feed team. I'd like to begin by introducing Dr. Kevin Fitzsimmons, Chair of the F3 team, who will be moderating today's webinar. Kevin is a professor at the University of Arizona, the former president of the World Aquaculture Society, and he's currently in Vietnam working on F3 diets with Dr. Locke Tran. Before we get started, I would also like to let you know that if you have any questions during the webinar, you can type them into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, and we will address them during the Q&A session following the panelists' presentations. With that, the floor is yours, Kevin.
Thank you, Annie. All right, welcome, everyone, and thanks for joining us today for Emerging Trends with Alternative Feeds for Salmonids. This is the fifth in a series of monthly F3 webinars we're hosting on the latest advances in aquaculture feed ingredients to replace fish meal and fish oil. And I think everybody knows why we need to replace these, because wild fish are a declining resource, and without the replacements, aquaculture is bottlenecked and cannot grow to feed a world population of 9 billion. But replacements are right around the corner. Our seminars feature the most promising ingredients so that aquaculture can continue to grow sustainably. For our next few webinars, we're taking a look at trends in the use of alternative ingredients in feeds for the biggest users of fish meal and fish oil: salmonids, shrimp, and the other carnivorous species. If progress can be made towards finding sustainable fish-free feeds for these species, then substantial headway can be made towards increasing forage fish populations worldwide. We're inviting feed companies, farmers, and researchers to discuss the latest advancements, and today's webinar will focus on the use of alternative ingredients in feeds for salmonids. So let's get started. First, we have Bill Kramer. Bill's the president of Star Milling. He's a third-generation farmer feed manufacturer. Following graduation from Claremont McKenna College, Bill operated his own farms for the production of replacement pullets and table eggs before joining his father at Star Milling in 1985. And I'll make a quick note, that was a couple years after I visited Star Milling, which was the first big feed mill I ever visited. And I had a great tour there and really informed me a lot about large-scale feed milling. But anyway, Paul is now the fourth generation in the family business. Star Milling has a full-line feed manufacturing plant in Southern California, where they produce feeds for poultry, livestock, horses, pets, and fish. They are a current competitor in the F3 Carnivore Challenge, and their annual feed production includes over 6,700 tons of aquaculture feed alone. So thank you, Bill, for joining us today. We look forward to your presentation.
My name is Bill Kramer. I'm the president of Star Milling Company. We are a manufacturer of animal feeds and pet foods. We're located in Southern California in the inland area. We manufacture all types of feeds. We started off manufacturing mostly poultry feeds years ago. We still manufacture layer diets. We manufacture different specialty feeds for equine. And for some time, we've also been manufacturers of aquatic feeds. In fact, our aquatic feed experience goes back a couple of generations. This is a multi-generational family business, because I remember as a kid in the mid-60s going up with my father to provide steam pellets to some of the California fish hatcheries up in the Eastern Sierra. So we've been doing aquatic feeds for some time. Most recently, back in the early 90s, we put in an extruder so that we could manufacture warm water fish diets, because mostly out here in our area, we're manufacturing catfish and tilapia feeds for the ponds out in the desert region that we can serve. It was probably back in, about 2014, 2015, that we were approached by Bill Foss, because he put the group together with Dr. Rick Barrows, who was doing some nutrition work for Bill, and Dave McFarland, who was managing a trout farm up in Northern California. And they were developing a fish-free diet for trout so that they could sell these fish into especially stores and restaurants that were looking for sustainable foods. This venture, you know, went well with us. It was a little bit difficult, but that's our business, is we will take formulas and toll manufacture them for the owner of the formula. Originally, these feeds, we used nut meats that are, you know, we can source in California. These would be broken pieces and things like that that the packers can't use for human food when they package pistachios and other nut meats like that. Those were some of the original formulas that were fish-free by using the nutritional value of these nut meats and so forth. The difficulty with that, though, is the fact that a lot of these products aren't well standardized. They're difficult to source. And so we had to find sources that were more more stable. Here recently, what we have done is now the formulas contain different, these would be vegetable protein fermented type manufactured products. I mean, these are becoming more available. They're expensive, but they're more available. So they would be protein, corn protein products, barley protein products. And so now we can make the formulas using these so that we can maintain a vegetable formula. These do well, the fish do well on these formulas, they convert well, but they're very expensive. And so having a true commercial product, probably not yet, but we are able to manufacture these products, and like anything else, some of these ingredient prices will come down, and producing fish with totally free fish meal and fish oil will become economical and not just a very specialty item, which is what we do. These feeds are, there's no mammalian protein in them, no fish protein, and no fish oil. Anyway, I think that answers most of the questions that were on the list, and I'm very happy to be able to talk about this and be part of the F3 webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. We appreciate that. So our next speaker is a good friend, Dr. Jessie Trushensky. She is the Chief Science Officer and Vice President for Animal Welfare for Riverines. Jessie is a fishery scientist with specific interest in conservation and commercial aquaculture. She also has served elected term as President of the American Fisheries Society. She manages Riverines' R&D portfolio and provides executive level science leadership across the company's operation. Riverines is the largest producer of farmed rainbow and steelhead trout in the Americas, with operations based in Idaho and Washington. Their current production is roughly 13,000 metric tons per year and still growing. And we are eager to learn about Riverines' experience using alternative ingredients and aquafeeds for salmonids. So let's please hear from Jessie.
Good morning. Good afternoon, or good evening, however it may apply to your time zone. and thank you for the opportunity to be with you. My name is Jesse Trushensky, and I'm the Chief Science Officer and Vice President of Animal Welfare for the Riverence Group. These days, I oversee a very diverse research portfolio, but my background is in fish nutrition and physiology. So the subject of sparing marine resources in aquaculture feeds is one that is never very far from my mind. To help everyone understand the Riverence Group's perspectives related to feed, I want to take a few minutes to tell you about how our company came about and a little about our philosophy. The founding of Riverence was motivated by respect for fish and recognition of the many ways that humans benefit from the continuing existence of thriving fish populations. Fish feed us, they employ us, they give us a chance to connect with the natural world. They provide ecosystem services that are key to our well-being and survival as a species, and they are part of the biological and cultural legacies we will leave to future generations. Riverence was founded by two men with a strong appreciation for this truth. One, a lifelong fisherman with a passion for wildlife and wild places, and the other, a fourth-generation conservation-minded rancher who saw the potential and efficiency in fish farming. Together, these two set out on a journey to understand what aquaculture is and how it can be practiced in such a way as to protect wild fish and satisfy demand for wholesome, delicious seafood. Riverence strives to do what is good for humans, to make wholesome, nutritious, tasty seafood accessible to all, to do what is good for the environment, and ultimately to do what is good for wild salmon. Our approach isn't about putting capture or recreational fisheries out of business, but rather to relieve pressure on these natural resources to allow them to be effectively managed and to thrive. After spending a few years exploring different types of aquaculture and testing different business models, they assembled a team and began building the Riverence Group to practice mindful fish breeding, sustainable land-based aquaculture, efficient distribution, and to bring fish farming into the modern era with new technologies. Today, the Riverence Group is comprised of three primary businesses: Riverence Brood, Riverence Farms, and Riverence Provisions. Riverence Brood, our breeding operation, is a producer of premium rainbow trout genetics and the only domestic commercial supplier of Atlantic salmon and coho salmon eggs in the United States. The flagship brood station is located in Washington State, but it was recently joined by three additional brood stations in Idaho in early 2020. Riverence Provisions and Riverence Farms, our farming and processing operations, are collectively the largest producer of rainbow trout and steelhead in the Americas. All of these facilities are located in Idaho, in and around the Hagerman Valley. As both breeders and farmers of trout and salmon, we recognize the significant challenges that face salmonid aquaculture domestically and worldwide, including those related to feed and our ability to raise our fish on feeds that are ecologically and economically sustainable. Sustainability isn't one size fits all, but at Riverence, we believe it is rooted in judicious use. Reduction fisheries existed before aquaculture rose to dominance in the seafood sector, and they will continue to exist with or without demand from our industry. Fish meal and fish oil can be used in poultry and pet foods, but the aquaculture industry can do more with these resources than other industries can. Fish meal and fish oil still have a role to play in aquaculture, and these resources can be used sustainably in aquaculture feeds. But that sustainable use can't support continued use at the current inclusion rates. Not if the aquaculture industry is going to grow as it must. But as we explore emerging sources of protein and lipid, we need to be mindful of both the ecological and economic sustainability of these ingredients and the implications they have for the quality and nutritional value of farmed fish. As a company, our goal is to reduce our use of fish meal and fish oil, but the ingredients we use instead must meet certain benchmarks. I've listed some of those here. They're not revolutionary, but these are important characteristics for all of us to recall and to consider. The feedstuffs must support rapid and efficient growth, but more than that, they must provide everything that our fish need to thrive. The feed formulations of the future must go beyond basic nutrition and provide the right balance of essential, conditionally essential, and non-essential nutrients needed for fish to realize their bioenergetic potential. They must also yield products that meet our and our customers' expectations for taste, nutritional value, safety, and so forth. Riverence can't accomplish the good we hope to and relieve pressure on wild salmon unless we can provide consumers with a product that tastes good and is good for them and for their families. And further to that point, we won't be in business to do that good work if the feeds aren't cost effective. Recognizing that there is a bit of a which came first aspect to ingredient availability, the ingredients we use to spare fish meal and fish oil are needed in sufficient quantities to allow for broad-scale use at meaningful inclusion rates. We recognize that cheap feeds are sometimes just that, and quality nutrition often comes with a higher price tag. But the feeds do have to be economical, not just for the financial health of our company, but for our customers. Riverence's goal is to be part of an aquaculture industry that puts superior seafood within everyone's reach, and we have to have cost-effective feeds to do so. I've listed a few ingredients here where we see value and possibility, but by no means is this an exhaustive list. A good bit of aquaculture feed currently comes from processed commodity grains and oil seeds, but there is more work to be done to fully exploit what is produced from agricultural processing. In particular, the possibilities and scale associated with fermentation of traditional crops is very exciting, as is the growing diversification of agriculture and the emergence of non-traditional grains and oil seeds. Although we recognize that genetic modification and related technology is a challenging topic for some, the science is sound, and GM oil seeds have perhaps the greatest potential to produce the largest volumes of long-chain omega-3 rich oils. Insect and invertebrate meals are a natural fit for aquaculture too, as are algae and related products, and these may have as much worth as functional ingredients as they do straight nutritional value. We also think that there is value to be gained in paying greater attention to the functional and physical properties of ingredients, not just what ingredients they contain, but how well they play together in a formulation and how suited they are to manufacturing. To wrap things up, I will say that what Riverence is striving for, to do good for people, for fish, and for the environment we all share, guides our feed choices. Although we see a place for marine origin ingredients in aquaculture feeds, our interests are aligned with the F3 initiatives. Doing more with less is one of the pillars of our operation, and sparing costly, limiting ingredients like fish meal and fish oil will help us do just that. We applaud F3's goal of helping innovation scale to meet the demands of the real world, and we are grateful for the opportunities it provides to those who are envisioning what is next in feed for Riverence and for the aquaculture industry as a whole. Finally, while the Riverence Group is not an R&D company per se, I am a dyed-in-the-wool researcher, and I firmly believe that my role, with Riverence and as a scientist in general, is to take data and turn it into information, and then take that information and turn it into action. The work that is being done by the F3 participants and others in this space is critical, and we welcome the opportunity to connect and learn from each other. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jesse. Appreciate that. I'd also like to make a quick reminder that if any of you have any questions during the webinar, please type them into the Q&A box that is at the bottom of your screen. We will address them during the question and answer session, okay? So moving on, our next speaker is Dr. Birgud Denstadli, who's the technical director for the Salmon Division of BioMar Norway. Birgud spent a decade in research before starting his commercial career in BioMar, where he has been involved in the transformation of salmonid feeds, including creating the first feeds utilizing farmed microalgae as a substitute for wild-caught marine resources. BioMar Group is a Danish feed company that produces aquaculture feeds for 45 different fish and shrimp species for more than 80 countries around the globe. They have 17 production sites around the world with a total annual feed production capacity of 2 million tons. We look forward to hearing more from Birgud and about BioMar's progress with alternative feed ingredients.
Hello, and thank you for having me on this session on emerging trends with alternative feeds for salmonids. My name is Birgud Denstadli, and I'm the technical director in BioMar Norway. As a feed producer, we basically construct feeds based on a defined set of nutrients. And in essence, the nutrients found in wild Atlantic herring, krill and shrimp would naturally represent the nutritional needs of Atlantic salmon. So 50 years ago, the aquaculture pioneers represented on this picture here, they kept it very simple. They used frozen and raw pelagic fish, as they knew very well that this was on the menu for wild Atlantic salmon. Of course, for practical reasons, there was a shift after a while from frozen and raw fish to dry extruded pellets. And in the early years, the ingredients in this compound feed, the extruded feeds, was mainly fish meal and fish oil. Of course, and as we all know, the fish farming increased in size, there was more pressure put on these marine ingredients, and that of course led to increased prices, as this is definitely fish meal and fish oil are limited limited in their availability. Of course, then for a company to be able to increase the raw material flexibility, it was extremely important for us to better understand the nutritional composition in these traditional marine ingredients, and then again represented by this Atlantic herring in the middle here. So if this herring then was broken down, we could say that, you know, there was a certain set of fat-soluble vitamins, there was a certain set of water-soluble vitamins, you have the minerals up here, you have the building blocks, the amino acids down here, and then you have essential fatty acids like EPA and DHA, you have antioxidants and carotenoids down here, and then of course you need your feed to contain a certain amount of energy. But then, in addition to traditional methods, more advanced methodology was also applied to better understand the secrets behind these marine ingredients and why they function so well in a feed for Atlantic salmon. And then, of course, having this knowledge about the traditional marine ingredients, that would enable us to construct a feed for Atlantic salmon without having a restriction on the ingredients to be used and increasing our raw material flexibility. So with all of this being mapped out, we would then essentially just bring all of this into the formulation software, and we could select raw materials based on their nutritional composition rather than the origin, you could say, of the raw materials. As you all know, the proteins are easily found. They are abundant, you could say, at least compared to the marine omega-3s. As we all know, the supply, the global supply of fish oil is limited, and that is and has been the large bottleneck for our industry. And I would say the number one challenge for us. But there are some alternatives. Microalgae are the primary producers of marine omega-3s. These nutrients accumulate in the marine ecosystem, where we depend on harvest and fish oil to provide these essential nutrients in aquaculture feeds. By using fermentation technology, we can bypass this traditional pathway and produce these nutrients in a controlled fashion, and thereby reduce the reliance on the wild fish stocks. So based on new knowledge, we have been able to increase our raw material flexibility. The vast majority of these new alternatives come from plant ingredients. In the recent years, we have been able to introduce new alternatives, like the black box on the top here, which would then represent algal products and fermented products. We introduced algal oil in 2016, and we have seen a large increase in the use of this new solution, you could say. The future of aquafeeds, I definitely think that we will see more fermented products. I think the algal oils and the algal products definitely will increase in the years to come. The circular proteins, typically insect meals, yes, that could definitely also be a solution. But then there's an element I would like to point at. And then you're talking about problem shifting. Yes, you are reducing the reliance on fish stocks, but keep in mind that the traditional marine ingredients, there is no land use involved, there is no freshwater use, relatively low energy requirement, and a low carbon footprint. For some of these new sources to produce the new ingredients, you need more energy. You perhaps also increase the carbon footprint, depending on where these raw materials are produced. But then, of course, there's also a benefit that the production is controlled and there is no contaminant exposure. For the terrestrial products, there is a long list of challenges related to land use, to water use, and perhaps also irrigation. The carbon footprint may be a bit higher, and there is also questions related to the use of pesticides. So this is definitely challenges to look at. So a quick summary, there are some challenges ahead, but we do have the knowledge to produce 100% fish-free feeds, and we have done this commercially and at full-scale production. Thank you.
Thank you, Vergard. We appreciate that. So our next speaker is Dr. Lindsay Pollock. She's the Sustainability Manager for Cargill Aqua Nutrition for the North Sea. Lindsay has worked in the aquafeed sector since 2007 and has held her current role for Cargill Aqua Nutrition since 2019. She is closely engaged with salmon farming customers on a range of sustainability issues and is also supporting Cargill's Sea Further sustainability program, which aims to reduce the environmental footprint of salmon farming by 30% by 2030. Cargill operates 40 feed manufacturing facilities around the world, with 19 of those fully dedicated to aquatic nutrition, and is currently producing 2 million tons of aquafeeds annually. So let's please hear from Lindsay about Cargill's new sustainability initiatives and research with aquafeeds.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Pollock, Sustainability Manager at Cargill Aqua Nutrition in the North Sea, responsible for sustainability in the Norway and Scotland salmon and trout markets. Cargill has a clear purpose: to nourish the world in a safe, responsible, and sustainable way. We help create 5 billion seafood meals per year, and we make feed for 30 aquatic species, including Salmonids, shrimp, and tilapia. In 2020, we made 1.9 million tonnes of feed, 1.2 million tonnes of which was for Salmonids. We make feed in 12 countries in our 19 dedicated aqua feed mills. R&D is important to keep our business moving forward, and we have 3 innovation centres. One in Calaco in Chile, which was a 10.5 million investment with a health R&D focus, in Deerdal in Norway, and in Elk River in the USA. With an estimated 10 billion people to feed on the planet by 2050, aquaculture will need to grow further to meet demand for healthy seafood as part of a sustainable diet. We want to provide feed solutions that grow the fish people want to eat, meeting consumer needs. And through a customer intimacy approach, we focus on delivering feeds that support healthy fish to thrive. We take a science-based approach and have a deep understanding of the core nutritional needs of aquatic species in the conditions that farmers raise them. We believe in giving the fish we feed a strong start to life, setting the foundations for healthy grow out. Cargill places a strong emphasis on feeds that can deliver positive health and welfare outcomes. And we're harnessing the power of digitisation to develop and support our customers with digital tools, taking stock and farming conditions into account to empower farmers to make better decisions, driving efficiencies and improving survival. We work in a complex value chain with many links, starting from the raw materials we source, the technology we use to manufacture them into high quality feed products, and transforming them into safe and nutritious food for the humans that consume them. The impacts we have as a business underpins the role we play to contribute to some of the key UN Sustainable Development Goals. Sustainability is a complex and evolving field, and collaboration with stakeholders is important to create solutions to industry challenges. In particular, we work with key stakeholder groups such as IFO, Marin Trust, and the Sustainable Fisheries Partnership to help us develop sustainable marine ingredient supply chains. But we also work with NGOs across a range of issues, and we also work pre-competitively to improve the performance of the whole aquaculture and aquafeed sector. Over the past 20 years, we've been able to reduce the marine ingredient inclusion in our feeds by 80%. We've focused on increasing the use of trimmings, and in our cold water salmonid feeds, our trimmings, meals and oils represented 35.5% of the marine ingredients we used in 2019. In some regions where availability is higher, that can be as much as 70%. 89% of the forage marine ingredients we used in our cold water species were Marin Trust certified. And of those, 48% of the forage ingredients could be traced back to MSC fisheries. 73% of the trimmings we used could be traced back to MSC fisheries. But as you can see now, there is a larger variety of ingredients in salmon diets. And we've moved away from focusing on single issues and are now engaged on managing a range of different raw materials. We want to ensure that all ingredients are responsibly sourced and select from those according to customer needs. But to do that, we need to have a wide basket of sustainable raw materials to choose from. And that means working across these multiple issues related to marine ingredients, plant ingredients, and looking at emerging novel ingredients. And we must take a holistic view on the environmental footprint of feed and farming. And now carbon footprint from the raw materials we source right through to the fish is a major area of focus for us. In March this year, we launched our Sea Further Sustainability Programme. Through the Sea Further Sustainability Initiative, we'll partner with our value chain to create solutions to help our customers reduce the carbon footprint of their salmon 30%. By 2030 against a 2017 baseline. And this will help the sector save 2 billion kilos of CO2 equivalents. That is the equivalent of 400,000 cars off the road in 1 year. And we've set an interim target of 15% reduction in GHGs by 2026. And we'll aim to do this by sustainable sourcing, transforming our supply chains where we will partner with our value chain to reduce the carbon footprint of materials, developing more sustainable supply chains for ingredients. And we'll maximise efficiency, using innovation to improve the productivity of fed salmon, doing more with less, which helps our customers deliver on their sustainability commitments. And we'll do this by caring for fish, safeguarding farmed fish, keeping them healthy and thriving through targeted nutrition and dedicated health and welfare solutions. Together, we can reinvent what responsible aquaculture looks like. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for some very, very nice presentations. Now I'd like to ask our panelists to turn on their videos, and I'll let you each briefly introduce yourselves before we begin the Q&A session. And for the audience, please take this time to type any additional questions you have into the Q&A box so that we can address them during this session. Lindsay, you're first on my screen. Why don't you go ahead first, please?
Hi, good morning. I'm joining you today from Scotland, where I'm working. I'm the sustainability manager for the North Sea region of Cargill Aquanutrition. So I've been working with the company since 2007 through a range of different roles, both in the commercial side of the business, but also dealing with sustainability. So my background is a PhD in aquaculture sustainability, working in Asia, but also been working in the North Sea region now since 2007.
Great, thank you. Bill, you're next on my screen. Why don't you say a few words, please? Introduce yourself again.
Yeah, again, I'm really in part of this as a manufacturer. We don't do the research, we don't do a lot of the nutrition and so forth, but the challenge that we've taken on is taking some of these formulations that are rather extensive in ingredients, difficult to source, be able to batch them and run them through an extruder and come up with a product that is uniform and that we're able to send to the farms.
Great, thank you, Bill. Jesse, please.
Hi, everyone. Again, I'm Jesse Trushensky. I'm the Chief Science Officer for Riverence. So we're participating here as primarily a consumer of aquaculture feeds and a fish producer. My background, like I said in my presentation, was primarily in fish nutrition. Now I have a few more hats that I wear for the company, but this is the one that's near and dear to my heart. Pleasure to be with all of you.
Thank you, Jesse. And Vigard, please.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for hosting this, Kevin. It's an honor to be at this event. And I could just say that I represent the technical department in BioMar. We are located in Trondheim, Norway. We also have our scientists. We have our sourcing parts of our sourcing department. So we basically kind of cover the range, you could say. So it's a really interesting topic, and of course it's also all about ensuring that we're able to commercialize this. That's the essence, I would say. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And actually, we've got the first question is actually for you. So kind of a two-parter. One, have you used photosynthetic algae in your feeds, or are they autotrophic? And the second part is, have you noticed any differences in taste or texture using the algae oil compared to fish oil?
Okay, yeah. And so to the first question, commercially, we haven't used autotrophic algae yet. We are looking into it. So there are certain R&D projects looking into this area. But when it comes to commercial products we're using, they're heterotrophic. When it comes to the taste and texture, we of course have undertaken panel tests of the final products. So we take this all the way to slaughter size and market relevant size, and there may be some numerical differences, but there is no kind of significant differences. So the taste is just as good as you could call conventionally fed salmon.
Okay, thank you. And so Jesse, we've got a similar question for you. Have you guys been using algae or algae oils in your salmonid feeds?
We have not had the opportunity to use any in our commercial feeds yet. It's something we're certainly open to. We follow the research and the kind of larger scale demonstration trials that have been conducted throughout the world with various salmonids, including with support from some of the folks that are on the screen right now. We're very encouraged by the positive results we're seeing. We just haven't had the opportunity ourselves yet.
Okay, thank you. So Lindsay, we've got a question for you. Could you speak about your selection process for the alternative ingredients that you're investigating for your See Further sustainability program?
Yes. So the alternative ingredients are really part of our strategy of having a wide basket of sustainable raw materials from a number of sources. In terms of how we evaluate the alternative ingredients, we have to look at them, you know, at the most basic level. You know, will fish eat it? And what is the nutritional contribution that it brings to the formulation? And what's the interplay between that ingredient and the other ingredients that are in a performance salmon diet? So we have to look at that in terms of its palatability and nutritional contribution. And we also have to look at what stages of the life cycle we can use this ingredient as well. It might not be applicable across the multitude of different feeds we make for different developmental stages. And some of these ingredients aren't necessarily a one-to-one replacer of some of the marine ingredients that they're trying to challenge in the diet for space. So we have to look at the sustainability credentials of that in a more broad spectrum as well. You know, what's the carbon footprint? What are the other LCA variables that come with this ingredient and how it's produced? We have to look at how available that is, whether that's going to be dependent on something that's got a seasonal dimension to it. And we also have to look at scalability, of course. We make nearly 2 million tons of feeds each year, you know, so we have to consider how scalable these options really are to put them into commercial use. So those are things that we really consider. And of course, we also have to have a focus on the cost. What does that inclusion do to the overall cost of the diet?
All right, thank you, Lindsay, appreciate it. Bagard, there's another one here for you. You specifically mentioned about alternative ingredients and their environmental impact. Could you speak a little bit about your work with the Brazilian soy farmers to stop deforestation and use certified soy?
Yeah, of course, we have to interact and have to work with the different suppliers in order to ensure that you know, everything is in order. And of course, we are also looking at alternative sources. I mean, soy is a resource that has a very extremely good nutritional profile. You also have soy crops in Europe, actually, and we also see that we are able to source the same type of soy protein concentrates from different parts of the world. But we definitely are engaging with suppliers of soy from Brazil, definitely.
Okay, thank you. So Bill, here's one. You're one of the competitors in the challenge. Could you speak a little bit about why you joined the challenge and why it's important to your company?
That's a great question. One of the main reasons is because that's our specialty, is obviously trying to manufacture things that are very different. We saw the challenge. We went over the formulas. We looked at them. We understood that it was something that we could probably do. It's not easy. I mean, we have a single screw extruder. Some of these diets were probably better made on twin screw extrusion equipment, where you get a higher amount of compression and so forth. The other difficulty with a lot of these salmonid diets is they're very high in oils. So it can take vacuum infusion in order to get the amount of oil that you want into the product. So the challenge was there, and I very much wanted to do it, and that came from me at the top. You know, I just, we looked at it, We kind of wonder, you know, is this really going to help us out? And I said, of course it is, because we're going to learn something about this. Because otherwise, most of our production is warm water fish feeds. By nature, they don't have the near amount of fish meal inclusion as the cold water fish diets do. And we did. We learned quite a bit out of being part of the process of fish refeed, and I think it's helped us out tremendously, because we're all trying to do the same thing. We're trying to produce protein for people from vegetable byproducts. I mean, that's no different from fish. It is with laying hens or cattle. I mean, that's what you're trying to do. Because if we don't do it through animals, they're going to do it through laboratories, and they're already starting to do that. And I think it's a great challenge for us to make a natural product this way.
Well, we've been using your tilapia diets as our control for a little over 40 years now at University of Arizona. So we appreciate all the good work you've been doing, Bill.
Yeah, thank you.
So Jesse, a question here for you. What alternative ingredients do you see as the most promising for trout feeds?
Sure. You know, I how much time do you have, right? You know, I highlighted a few of them in my presentation. So, you know, again, some of the insect proteins that we've talked about, the algal meals and oils, certainly. A lot of the fermented products we're very interested in. We're using some of those materials already. You know, I think for a producer as large as we are, you know, the areas where we see the most potential are those ingredients that have kind of figured out how to check that scalability box, right? Because, you know, with the number of fish that we produce every year, even the most perfect ingredient, if it's not available at scale, isn't going to help us really push the envelope in terms of reducing fish meal and fish oil inclusion in our feeds. So that's probably one of the most important, if not the most important criterion that we pay attention to, is the scalability and certainly the cost, and of course, all of the other variables that Lindsay and Vegard and Bill have already highlighted. So, but yeah, I think those types of ingredients are probably the highest up on our radar screen, but there's so many more, right? And I think that's the point that others have been making, but I guess I'll reinforce that message that it's not just one ingredient. It can't just be one ingredient. You know, it has to be a full ingredient basket, or, you know, a diverse portfolio, whatever analogy you want to use. You have to have a lot of different options on the table.
Yeah. Okay, great. Well, speaking to that, this question came in both for Lindsay and Vegard. We'll let Lindsay go first. Do you see a chance for single cell protein to become a major part in salmonid diets? And what about the CO2 footprint of such single cell proteins in comparison to other ingredients, which Vegard mentioned? So Lindsay, why don't you go first, please?
So it is definitely something that's an area of interest for us, and we've spoken about our partnership with White Dog Labs in the media, who are producing single cell proteins as well. There are possibilities in terms of the protein and amino acid fit, and where we can use that in the diet. So the question is, you know, about scaling up these initiatives. I think, you know, that is one that shows potential. In terms of the carbon footprint of a lot of these things, I think these are the things that are, you know, emerging as these technologies come on stream and start to be produced. Then we have to start, you know, looking at the LCA studies that are done by these producers and seeing how that stacks up. But I think it's, you know, it's an interesting question, because if I raise the issue about trade-offs, I think Vegard covered that nicely in his presentation, that we have to evaluate all of these raw materials across a number of dimensions, and there may be, you know, discussions to be had about what's the job to be done by including certain materials in the diet. Is it driving towards lower carbon footprint? Is it driving you know, variety in the basket, you know, are you selecting for something that's perhaps offering better growth performance or better fish health and welfare outcomes? So we've got a number of things to consider.
Rod, do you want to add something to that?
Yeah, and I have to be positive. I definitely think that, yes, I think we will see single cell proteins in our formulations in the years to come. And if I go 10 years back in time, back in 2011, 2012, we said to ourselves that, you know, we need to resolve the bottleneck related to long-chain omega-3s. And of course, we see where we are right now. It kind of took us 5 years to be able to kind of commercialize that. And it's a commercial commodity right now, I would say. But then, you know, the interesting and the things here to discuss is, of course, this has to be produced at a certain scale. That's number one. And then you also, depending on where you're producing this, that will have a huge impact. For example, if you have an electricity grid that is mainly hydropowered, that would be a huge benefit for you as a producer of single cell proteins. If the background is coal, you could say, in that same electricity grid, then that's a challenge. So it all boils down to where you produce these new ingredients. And I think another element that is also a benefit for these fermented and single cell products is that there's no interaction with the environment, and there's no exposure to potential contaminants, you know, that go way back in time, but still are there. And that is, of course, a challenge with some of the ingredients that we are harvesting from the wild. They are exposed to whatever is in their surroundings. So we see that, you know, with the formulations that we're doing with these new ingredients from an R&D perspective, there are more or less contaminant free, which is a huge benefit, of course.
Yeah. Just a quick question that I'll pose to everybody. For these life cycle analyses of these different things, to me, it seems like they're kind of all over the place from different sources. And is there any particular source or methodology for these LCAs that you like better than others?
I'll have a go at that if anyone else wants to start. The product environmental footprint category rules, which are, you know, due to be legislated for by the EU, are one of these ways that, you know, we've move towards, because we want to appreciate the need for standardization of some kind here so that people can compare apples and apples on products. And the same goes for us trying to evaluate raw materials relative to one another. So I think it does help to have some standardization, or at least a very good understanding, so that you can interpret the studies of these LCA analyses and the methodologies that are used. And you have to know, you know, how the result can be affected by the approach that's been taken.
Bill, do you guys look at these very often as far as your, you know, as a miller, these life cycle analyses, or is it still more have to be seat of the pants as to which ingredients you guys have to pick?
Well, yeah, I think the evolution of the whole thing is you know, we're starting with different nut meats that we could source in California, broken meats from processing of pistachios. You've also got walnuts and almonds grown in the state, but they're just not standardized well enough that you can put together a diet that's going to come out the same every time. So now we're starting to use a lot of these vegetable proteins, manufactured vegetable proteins, fermented products, and so forth. They're expensive, but they're standardized. And so you're going to have an analysis come out of the feed that's going to be the same every time. And you, as far as least costing on a lot of this stuff, quite frankly, the diets that we're producing now probably really aren't at a commercial level just because of their costs. We do have customers that are selling fish into certain markets and so forth that can get that premium. But it's going to take time to get to a point on some of these diets to use less fish meal and so forth. And certainly in the warm water fish, we're practically there. But with the cold water fish, it's more of a challenge. But we'll get there. It's just going to take time, and new ingredients will come up, and current ingredients that we're using, their costs will go down as these fermented products become more produced.
Okay, good. Thank you. Okay, here's one that was just directed to anyone who wants to take a shot at it. Looking 20 years into the future, do you think alternative proteins such as insect protein will have scaled to the level where they will reduce feed costs relative to conventional ingredients?
No, I think it's already starting to happen. Yeah, it's very easy to source, say, insect proteins at this point in time.
Yeah.
We haven't done a lot of inclusion of it yet, but they're certainly available, mm-hmm. especially black soldier fly larva and some of the others.
Good.
I would say history is a pretty good teacher on this. And, you know, there are ingredients that are being used today in aquaculture feeds that are very commonplace, things like soy protein concentrates, corn protein mm-hmm. concentrates that, you know, were originally developed as human food ingredients and were way, way too costly to even consider for using in aquaculture feeds 20 years ago. So it's happened before for many ingredients. I don't think there's any reason to think that it won't happen for some of these emerging materials today.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay, Rugard here. What are the major parameters that feed producers consider while choosing alternative protein sources?
Well, I think the number one would, of course, be to understand the nutritional value of the product. That's kind of we cannot look away from that. We have to know that it's nutritionally sound and that it has a value in our formulations. We have to know that it's processable, meaning that whenever we take it into our mills, we are able to produce and extrude our feeds in a normal way without doing too many adjustments. That's an important thing. I mean, we are a 24/7 operation. It's non-stop production, and we cannot allow ourselves to have large issues related to the daily operation, you could say. So that's a vital and important part. But then, of course, you also the elements that have been coming up in the later years is that we see that markets and consumers are asking for new elements talking to the retailers. So we have to kind of adapt to that, and we have to find new solutions, new raw materials, and meet that request basically. So I think that's the major change. The consumer has kind of changed, and then of course also markets are different around the world. So the preferences in Europe versus Americas and Asia, they're different. And our customers kind of also know about that, of course. So there's a lot of elements to be considered, for sure.
Okay, good. So Lindsay, we've got one here. Interesting question. Even if alternative materials are used, will the use of artificial ingredients, alternative feeds for salmon farm on a large scale have an impact on the food chain of other organisms in the ocean? After all, the feeds are only developed for salmon. Will they cause marine pollution or affect other organisms, I guess, around cages?
That's one that I would hope through feeding and, you know, the quality of the diet, the, you know, I think what you're talking about is whether waste feed would somehow cause an issue. Is that?
I think that's what they're getting at, either pellets that float out or if there's fecal waste, you know, that settles down. I guess they're looking at maybe both.
So our objective as a feed manufacturer is to make a pellet with a really good quality technical ability to be fed in water so that the fish has an opportunity to eat it and convert it well. We're also, you know, key to our business is really having nutrient retention in the fish so that we have good digestibility, high quality ingredients. So I would hope that over, you know, the future years that digestibility will continue to improve in the salmonid feeds, and as a result, environmental impact ought to decrease, more nutrients that are retained in the fish.
Okay, good, thank you. Okay, here's one that just came in, and I'll give this one to Bill first, but open up to anybody else who'd like to respond as well. We are a USDA-funded small startup focused on insects for fish feed. We haven't started any work with fish feed companies yet. What would be a good first step to connect with a feed company?
Talk to the buyer.
Pretty straightforward.
The main thing would be to contact us, give us a nutritional profile of the product that you have. How it's standardized so that we know it's going to show up the same every time, what kind of form it comes in. Obviously, the easiest thing is if it comes in a meal, it makes it very easy for inclusion. So that would be the main thing. Contact us, let us know availability and what the nutritional profile of the product is.
Okay. And I'll add that pretty much applies to any other ingredient, not just insects.
Yep.
Okay. And something kind of similar. What is the role of major feed suppliers in supporting emerging alternative ingredients during this phase when their business models are not yet at a financially viable scale?
Well, I could answer that if that's I think we need to support startups. We need to give them attention. We need to look into their own R&D and perhaps also be able to collaborate in smaller projects to be able to better understand the value of their product, even though it may be an extremely small scale. We all start somewhere in a way, and I think it's important to support good initiatives. You are not at scale from day one. That's of course. So our approach is to listen to everyone and at least talk to them and invite them to partnerships and meetings.
I think just building on that, I think what these companies need is commitment, and they need that commitment to make a long-term development with their business. And that needs to be pulled right through the value chain from the downstream. So they have to have commitment and effectively have that so that they can turn novel into mainstream ingredients.
Good. Okay. We have a lot of listeners, participants in China for this. Here's one of their questions. Are there any companies in China using your feeds? What are your comments and suggestions for Chinese marine salmon farming? Would you want to start there first?
Yeah, I mean, we do have a joint venture in China, and I'm not 100% sure whether we are providing salmon feeds in China, but at least we do have operation in China, and I have to admit I don't have the full overview of the ingredient portfolio, you could say, at these factories. But I mean, as a global company, this is the novel ingredient area is definitely something that we're looking into adapting in all of our 17 production units, for sure.
Thank you. Lindsay, Cargill?
Yeah, I mean, I think I don't have the full overview of that business in China, but I'm happy if you'd like to drop me a line and I'll connect them to the right person to answer that.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Well, we kind of touched on this before, but it came up again. How does the effect of alternative ingredients compare to that of fish meal? Is there a change in the flavor and texture of the salmon product?
Are you then referring to the feed or to the fish, the end product?
Ah, good. Well, I think they are talking about the end product of their flavor and texture of the salmon product, but I guess palatability to the salmon is equally important.
Yeah, I can answer that. So, I mean, at least based on the relatively large portfolio documentation we have with novel ingredients, we do not see extreme shifts in palatability for the fish, and or palatability for the end consumer, you could say. So, I would say that there's a relatively neutral effect, you could say, by substituting these protein ingredients and also the alternative lipid ingredients.
From the fish producer perspective, you know, it's something that we're obviously hyper aware of. We're very proud of the taste of our fish, and we don't want that to change. We want that, well, I guess it could always change for the better, but we certainly don't want it to get worse. And yeah, I mean, the potential is there. I would agree with what Vegard said, that the effects are probably fairly minor, fairly subtle in most cases, unless you're doing something very strange with your feed formulations. You know, it's something that we pay close attention to, because, you know, for the fish producer, you know, it's we talk about how it's difficult to get someone to maybe try your product for the first time. It's really difficult to get them to try it a second time if they didn't like it the first time. And so that's a huge risk for a fish producer, is any negative effects to your flavor profile. So while it's maybe not a great likelihood, the consequences of that are, you know, significant. So it's something we pay close attention to.
Yeah, from my knowledge, the diets that we've been able to produce for 2xC have been, the fish are very well accepted by the consumer, and there hasn't been any issues regarding taste or flavor of the fish.
Mm-hmm. Okay. This one kind of, I'll give everybody a quick shot at this. Does the vegetable protein material refer to algae, but maybe a better way to phrase it is anybody using whole algae as an ingredient, like a vegetable protein, rather than just using the algae for algae oil?
We're not using it at the moment, and I think it's a question really around about nutrient density with this one, so that could be one of the challenges here, the form that the product comes in, with the ability to use that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then another question Birgit, you mentioned fermentation technology. The question is that used by BioMar, or is this fermented ingredients that you get from somebody else?
Good question. No, we do not ferment ourselves. So we are relying on suppliers to do this for us in a way. And we see that this is, there's a lot of startups and companies that look into fermentation technology as a new methodology to produce protein and lipid ingredients.
Okay. Very good. Very good. Right, just a whole thing about feeding tilapia. We'll save that for the next session as opposed to this one on salmonids. Sorry, let me see here if there's anything else really. How do industry representatives look at the possibilities of closing the loop on the farm? Could mussels, other low trophic marine cultured species supply marine aquaculture with considerable amounts of protein, omega-3. Lindsay, why don't we let you take that one? Do many of your farms in Scotland start that now with multi-trophic or anything like that?
Yeah, so I think there's definitely an area of interest in integrated multi-trophic aquaculture systems or IMTA. And whether, you know, those can be used as part of a circular approach to using waste streams that are generated perhaps from other marine activities such as aquaculture and then circling them back. So I think it is interesting, but again, it has to meet some of these criteria as well around about how we go about using novel ingredients, the scalability, the quality of the product, the availability of the product. So it is interesting. It's still early days. The other thing is around about the regulatory side of that. You know, in some countries that might be more favourable or less favourable depending on where the production is.
Yeah, good comment. I agree. And I think that the essence here is I think there is a big value in having different, let's call it niche productions, to have a variety within the aquaculture sector. I think that's extremely useful and positive. When it comes to kind of closing the loop and look at the circular aspect here, I think it's you have to look at the logistics also when it comes to the feed mills, because that's kind of a challenge perhaps if you're looking into kind of capturing the waste and transferring this into ingredients. You have to do that in a systematic way in order to be able to have a tight operation, you could say, when it comes to your free feed production.
Okay. All right, tell you what, let's have this last one just be a round robin, let everybody have a crack at it and maybe include any final comments you want here. So is full replacement of wild caught marine ingredients at commercial scale possible for salmonids? In your opinion, when could we see this happen on a large scale? Jesse, you want to go first?
Sure. Well, I think the short answer is that it is already happening for some companies that specialize in this kind of work. And I'm sure Bill will touch on that in his remarks. So, is it possible? Yes. Is it, you know, when is it going to happen? Right now and going into the future. But, you know, it's still, you know, completely fish oil, fish meal free feeds are still a very small sliver of the overall market. But I guess what I would say in response to that question, but also kind of in my concluding remarks here too, is that you know, it doesn't have to be one size fits all, right? That's one of the strengths of the aquaculture industry as a whole is that we don't all raise the same species. We don't all use the same production systems, rearing systems. We don't, some people do land-based, some people do net pens, some people do all sorts of different things, pond culture. It's a, in my view, sustainability for the whole sector is about finding what works for your natural resources, your regulatory climate, your water resources, and everything else that you kind of find yourself in. And so, you know, for those companies that are able to go fish meal, fish oil free right now, that's excellent. And I hope that we see more and more of those. But, you know, again, sustainability doesn't have to be one size fits all. It's about finding what fits for all of us to lift the whole sector. And I think that's something that I've heard echoed in various places throughout all of the presenters' comments. And I really thank them for that.
Thank you, Jesse. Bill.
Yeah, I think Jeff said it very well. It can be done. It's being done. It's on a very limited basis, though. It's for fish producers that have very specialized markets that they go into, and they're rather small markets. But the development process is there, and it's really rather fascinating, and we're not through yet.
All right, good. Bigard, how about you?
Yeah, I totally agree on the comments here, and I think it's I totally agree on the comment that you know, there is a diversity within the aqua sector, and we also see that in our customer portfolio here in Norway. I mean, their approach is relatively different, could be. So, but from our point of view, we just as a supplier of fish, we just have to be able to have that nutrient flexibility and raw material flexibility. So we have already done this at commercial scale. We have produced salmon up to market relevant size, and this has been sold on the market in fish pen systems in Norway. So it is definitely 100% doable. It's all about the price of the products, of course, and the perception of the market. So, but I have to say also that, as a final note, I'm really optimistic about the years to come and the potential and the possibilities we have to continue the development of future aquafeeds, for sure.
All right, thank you. And Lindsay.
Thanks. I think it's a, you know, an interesting point about the diversity in terms of the customers we serve and the feed they need to produce the fish they want to produce. And I think, you know, we have moved away from a single focus necessarily on driving down on single ingredient types and trying to really diversify the sustainability or the availability of sustainable ingredients in the basket. So that we can meet these needs with sustainable ingredients of many different types and choose those for the formulations. I think it is possible to have these feeds that we're discussing here of fish-free feeds. But I think the bigger overarching issue is to have sustainable feeds and sustainable feed ingredients coming into the basket and have that flexibility. And that's the approach that we take, is to play a wider field here, and that enables room for others to come in with products, novel ingredients, vegetable concentrates, and other things that we can start to look at using so that the industry can grow.
Good. Well, thank you very much. And Lindsay, please give my regards to Dave, Rob, and Ann, please. And Jesse, give Jim a hug for me. So I want to thank all of you for these presentations and discussions today. Our global audience today, including folks in China, was a little over 24,000. So it was a great discussion. And As you all know, salmonids currently consume over 23% of global fish meal and 60% of global fish oil. What we've heard today, I think, is that replacing fish meal and fish oil in the diets is technically possible and is on the path to becoming a commercial reality. This gives us hope for a future of feed that is not dependent on dwindling marine resources, but instead strengthened by having multiple tools to meet nutritional requirements. We hope you all enjoyed this seminar, Please join us for our next webinar, which will be on emerging trends with alternative feeds for shrimp on July 15th. And also, before you go, we'd like to take a couple minutes. I hope you'll watch our closing video from the F3 team. So thank you all again.